Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to Godrej Agrovet Limited's earnings conference call. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode. There will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal for an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Meet Shah from CDR India. Thank you and over to you.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us on Godrej Agrovet's Q2 and H1 FY22 earnings conference call. From the company, we have Mr. Nadir Godrej, Chairman of the company, Mr. Balram S. Yadav, Managing Director, and Mr. S. Varadaraj, Chief Financial Officer. We would like to begin the call with a brief opening remarks from the management, following which we will open the forum for an interactive question and answer session. Before we begin, I'd like to point out that certain statements made in this call may be forward-looking in nature, and a disclaimer to this effect has been included in the earnings presentation shared with you earlier. I would like to now invite Mr. Nadir Godrej to make his initial opening remarks. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, everyone. I welcome you all to the Godrej Agrovet conference call. I hope you are doing well and are staying safe. The second wave of COVID-19 in quarter one fiscal year 22 had significantly impacted the economic recovery seen in the preceding quarters, especially in rural India, which had much stricter lockdown. After a good start to the southwest monsoon, it was marked by extreme localized rainfall events, an unusually dry August, and an abnormally wet September resulted in lower kharif sowing. COVID-19 cases have started declining steadily in quarter two fiscal year 22. Key macroeconomic indicators such as GST collection, purchasing managers index, unemployment rates, etc., also signal a recovery. We expect the economic recovery to be faster in the second half of the year. At Godrej Agrovet Limited, we continue to focus on employee safety and business continuity. I'm happy to share that 100% of our eligible employees have been vaccinated with at least one dose, and 85% of employees have been vaccinated with both doses. Moving to the financial and operational performance, the key highlights and developments for the second quarter and the 6 months ended 30th September 2021 are as follows. Quarter two fiscal year 22 and H1 fiscal year 22 was a mixed bag for Godrej Agrovet Limited. The total income registered a healthy growth of 25.4% and 26.7% respectively in the current quarter and the half year over the corresponding previous period. The consolidated profit before tax recorded a modest growth of 3.1% and 2.7% respectively for quarter two fiscal year 22 and first half fiscal year 22. Please note that for the second quarter and half year of fiscal year 21, total income includes 9.6 crores and profit before tax, total income excludes 9.6 crores and profit before tax excludes 4.8 crores of income earned from sale of real estate. Our consolidated balance sheet remains strong with net debt to equity of 0.58 as on 30th September 2021. Now I will discuss the key financial and business highlights of each of our business segments. In animal feed, the growth momentum in volumes continued in quarter two fiscal year 22 across feed categories, resulting in robust growth in revenues and profitability. The segment revenue and segment results grew by 48.8% and 21% respectively during the quarter on the back of volume growth of 20.6%. For the half year, the segment sales grew by a healthy 41.4% and segment results were up by 26.8%. Realization of R&D benefits and introduction of new products supported improvement in the segment results. We had a very good quarter in the vegetable oil segment. Our segment revenues and segment results grew by 36.9% and 88.5% respectively. Higher yields and higher end product prices contributed to the growth. Prices of crude palm oil and palm kernel oil increased by 55% and 76% in quarter 2 fiscal year 22 over quarter 2 fiscal year 21. Our oil extraction ratio increased by 1% in the quarter. For the half year, our segment revenues and results have grown by 53.2% and 131.1% respectively. In the standalone crop protection business, segment revenue registered a degrowth of 12.6%. Segment results also declined by 24% as erratic and inconsistent monsoon rains resulted in lower sowing of major crops in the Kharif and reduced application opportunities for our agrochemical products. Margins were further impacted by steep inflation in raw material prices, which could not be absorbed, resulting in lower margins in pesticides. Even for the half year ended September 2021, our segment results declined by 7.6%. Moving to the performance of our subsidiaries, Astec Life Sciences posted a decline in revenue and EBITDA in quarter 2 fiscal year 22 of 33.8% and 29.9% respectively. The performance for the quarter was adversely impacted by the closure of the plant due to floods for about 15 days. Global shortage of containers limited the ability to ship goods, resulting in deferment of sales. However, we believe that on a full-year basis, Astec will maintain moderate growth in its top line and profitability levels. After a challenging first quarter, our poultry subsidiary, Godrej Tyson Foods Limited, registered a revenue growth of 40.4% in quarter 2 fiscal year 22 and EBITDA growth of 12.2%, supported by higher volume and improved realization in live bird and yummy segments. For the half year, Godrej Tyson has reported an EBITDA of rupees 9.9 crore, a degrowth of 67.5%, primarily on account of higher feed costs due to significantly higher raw material prices. Our dairy subsidiary, Creamline Dairy Products Limited's performance was impacted by higher milk procurement prices as compared to the previous year. During the second quarter, revenues increased by 9.7% year-on-year, but EBITDA at 4.1 crore was lower than the corresponding previous period. We launched fruit yogurt, which has received an encouraging initial response. For the half year ended September 2021, revenue grew by 11.1%, but EBITDA declined by 95.3%. Revenue from value-added products grew by 38.2% year-on-year in quarter 2 fiscal year 22 and 27.1% year-on-year in the first half fiscal year 22. GAVL's joint venture in Bangladesh, ACI Godrej, recorded another quarter of strong performance with revenue growth of 17.5% in quarter 2 fiscal year 21. Growth was driven by strong volume across all feed categories, cattle, poultry, and aqua feed. This concludes our business and financial performance update for the quarter and half year. With this, I close my opening remarks. We will be now happy to take your questions.
Thank you very much, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on their touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handset while asking questions. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. To ask a question, please press star and one at this time. The first question is from the line of Aniruddha Joshi from ICICI Securities. Please go ahead.
Many thanks for the opportunity. Sir, two questions from my side. The vegetable oil segment has done extremely well during the quarter. So, with palm oil prices remaining high and even the various news flows also indicating it remaining at a higher level, can we expect similar performance in H2 as well? Or do you see any cost pressures, etc., that can build up in the business model? And also, how is the progress in terms of the new hectares added, in terms of the new hectares that fresh hectares as well as the hectares which are can be used for the plantations also? That is question number one. And then second question, obviously, this is repeated in earlier quarters also, but still dairy business continues to remain still in lackluster mode. And now with inflation expected in dairy, maybe after the flush season, so how do we see the dairy business from the value creation perspective over next 2 to 3 years? Yeah, that's it. Thank you.
So thank you very much for your question, Anirudh. So first question is that yes, prices have been extremely good in the oil palm segment, but all our profits have not come only from price variance. I think there is a substantial improvement in efficiency also. Yeah. And if you remember in my last meeting, I said that we have taken a help of consultants called Renoir to work on efficiency parameters. Plus, we also have initiated several R&D initiatives which have improved our oil extraction ratio. So when you see our annual numbers, we will show a significant improvement in our OER, which is a direct injection into our profitability because we pay on the weight of the fruit. So definitely, oil prices is not likely to come down in next few months, but of course, they will not remain at the level of H1. Today, the prices are close to about 106 rupees. And you know that the government has reduced duty from 32.5% to 27.5%. But having said that, the reports are still very bullish. So my sense is that prices are going to remain like this till February or March. The next question you asked is that how will be the second half? So second half normally is 70-30. 70% of the fruit comes in the first half and 30% comes in the second half. But this year is likely to be different because of the change in the monsoon pattern. So we are likely to have a split of about 62-63% in the first half and about 37-38% in the second half, which is very, very encouraging considering the oil extraction ratio and all the efficiencies have kicked in the latter part of the second half, which will continue in this quarter also. So we are very bullish on that. I think unprecedented profits and improvement in efficiency will be seen. So our, let me also brief you on expansion plan. You must have known that this National Mission on Oil Palm has started by central government. And I think one of the meetings has been held in Northeast, where a lot of mistakes by the companies and the government were discussed. And we have been invited by Arunachal Pradesh government. Our first team has already gone and looked at an opportunity of anything around 35 to 40,000 hectares. Of course, a lot of work needs to be done. We have also made a laundry list of things which the state government has to do. So I think that MOU is likely to be signed next week. Next quarter. As far as the regular increase is concerned, I think a net increase of 3 to 3,500 hectares will happen this year also, which is happening for last several years. And I must also tell you that 18th of November is the meeting of that National Oil Mission, Oil Palm in Hyderabad, focused at Telangana, Hyderabad, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. So let us see, the government is pulling best foot forward, but I must also say that the states are still dragging their feet and not fulfilling their obligations. So we will let you know what is the progress maybe in the next quarter. But we are very optimistic because this scheme is very, very, I would say, fair. On milk, yes, you're absolutely right. We are still not out of the hole we are in. Our big hits to the volumes in milk was because of our over-dependence on institutional segment. I think that has not picked up. I can only say that about 10 to 20% of that segment has come back. And we are hopeful that as the months go by, we will continue to improve our milk volume, particularly in the institutional segment. Whatever little growth you have seen over past several months is all retail, which we are all very happy about because it is very sticky. The second thing is that the positive part is very good growth in value-added products in the future. The salience is still low, but if we chug along at 50-60% growth per annum on the base we have, I think 2-3 years later, we will make this business more sustainable from profit point of view. The third thing is that, yes, we have 30% dependence in our business system on milk prices. And there has been no flush in the buffalo milk, actually the prices have gone up by about 10% in last, which is a big hit to us. And second thing is that the cow prices, particularly in southern India, have not dropped in spite of flush because cooperatives continue to support the farmers by paying good price. So we are in a little bit of fix, but I think that progressively things will improve as the salience improves. Products are doing well, and we are hopeful. Of course, I've been telling that in several quarters, but I think several steps we have taken, I think we will see some improvement in the coming quarters.
Okay. So this is very helpful. Many thanks.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Next question is from the line of Prakash Kapadia from Anived Portfolio Managers. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Thanks for taking my question. I had, two questions. As we've seen in most of, the sectors.
Sorry to interrupt, Prakash.
Yeah.
May I request to speak slightly louder? Your voice is a bit feeble.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. I was saying, as seen in, most of the sectors, smaller players are finding it difficult to manage growth in these challenging times, especially, given what inflation we are seeing across sectors. So which segment do we think, we can see higher market share gains? Is there an opportunity in, 2-3 segments in which we are operating? And, in the first half, what are the price hikes we've taken in the animal feed and dairy segment? And lastly, on the input side, how are we planning, inventory and procurement, given, the variations on input cost on a weekly, daily basis?
Prakashji, thank you very much. Excellent question. So if you ask me, both in cattle and poultry feed, we have benefited partly because of other players becoming a little weak and not able to find working capital that easily. And you must have also seen that the soya meal prices, which is the chief ingredient of shrimp feed and poultry feed. In poultry feed, soya meal inclusion is 25%. In shrimp feed, it is 35%. Everybody has got hit in profitability except us. Now, why this magic has happened? So one of the things is that we have been talking about all our R&D initiatives to bring in substitutes for such volatile raw material. And I think full benefit of that can be seen this year in poultry feed segment, where our market share has gone up. And our profitability, we would be the only poultry feed player in the country, even though several companies are unlisted, who are profitable in the first half. The second thing I must tell you, in cattle feed, we had a very big problem. We were the number one company in the country, but not a single state we were number one. And I think with new launches, with very high performing feeds, at least in Maharashtra, we have retained the number one position once again. And we believe the growth in cattle feed, which we have shown in the first half, which is close to about 14%, will be continued in the second half also and may improve. Here again, market share gains are there. After years of decline for last 2 years, we are showing improvement in shrimp feed segment. And this year, we have again grown shrimp feed by about 40%. Of course, it is on a low base. From last year, we were 15,000 and we are close to 22,000. But that also is also reflective of the fact that we are doing something right there. Of course, the profitability took a very big hit because soya extraction went from 40,000 rupees to about 1 lakh rupees a ton. And the quality of soya we use is superior to what is used in poultry. Similarly, in oil palm plantation also, we would see improvement in market share. Of course, it was not a good year from volume point of view in fruits, but in terms of oil extraction ratio backed by our R&D inputs and efficiency improvements, we will see an improvement in OER. And OER is very precious, you know that.
Yeah.
So these are a few areas where we have gained market share. I can definitely say that fish feed was one area where we were very optimistic, but the party spoiler was COVID. Because what happens in fish is that the safest way to keep inventory is to keep it in water. So that's what happened in April, May and June when the farmers did not harvest. Of course, harvesting happened in the next quarter and now replacement has started. So we are expecting major improvement in fish feed also and improvement in our market share also.
Okay.
Plus in yummies and in value added products, we can share, we have data from Nielsen where our market shares have grown particularly in the in yummies, which is the value-added chicken and vegetarian products in Godrej Tyson Foods Limited, and Nielsen tracks, I think, flavored milk, etc.
Yeah.
Where our market share have improved. So I think the what has hit us very badly, I would say, is the cost inflation, particularly in our Godrej Tyson business, in our milk business, and in our shrimp feed business. Of course, we have benefited in the animal feed business and OPP business because of that.
And if you could comment on, you know, how are we managing the procurement inventory and something on the kind of price hikes which we've absorbed, any further price hikes on the anvil given what we are seeing on the input side?
So except for one area, that is shrimp, where the price hike could not be taken because, you know, Andhra Pradesh is very active in price controls in everything. And I think that harassment continues in all industries, including us, where we could only pass on less than 50% of the cost increase. In other areas, we were very prompt and 100% of cost increase was passed on, albeit with a time lag, particularly in cattle feed, in fish feed, in poultry feed. So there we have, don't have a problem. Personally, I love this situation because this is where our muscle will come. At one time, we were holding 4 months stock of corn and 5 months stock of soya meal and about 4 or 5 months stock of other proteins. And that you can see flowing into our profit statement. And in spite of the fact that we took some time in increasing prices, almost there was a 2 to 3 week lag every time we took a price increase. And I must also tell you that I think some way the government numbers and the industry numbers in production have to be taken with a pinch of salt. There are reports in April on soya meal excess in the country. The price was 33,000 rupees ex Indore, and the price in August was 1 lakh rupee a ton ex Indore. So I think we just have to make sure that we improve our information. And I think this is an opportunity for us. It's not a problem anymore.
Understood. Thanks. I'll join back if I have more questions. Thank you.
You can ask another one.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Abhineet Kulkarni from Techquity Investments. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir. I have two questions. The first one is on capital employed. So in FY21, I remember we moved partially away from supplier financing to short-term borrowings. So this had an impact on our capital employed representation. So my question is, during the last two quarters, have we seen more migration from supplier financing to short-term borrowings? That is one. And the second one is, the investor presentation mentions that milk procurement prices have remained significantly higher. So I just wanted to know what percentage of a milk procurement today happens from farmers versus via agents. That's all from my side. Thank you.
Working capital.
On the capital employed, our drive to sort of
move from acceptances to borrowings continued, close to 600 crores is what the sort of drop in acceptances has been vis-a-vis H1 of last year. And that's what sort of has flown directly in increasing our borrowings. So that's on the capital employed. And
yeah.
So what is this? Where is this here?
This is
milk procurement.
Milk procurement. Directly.
So we procure about 700,000 liters of milk per day. And we had started direct procurement from the farmers. For last 1 year, little bit of setback there because we have maintained whatever we were procuring from the directly from the farmer, which is close to about 17-18% of our requirement. And because of COVID, I think that could not be accelerated. But I think the effort has started once again in there. Then we have our own collection center, which are run by third parties, which is also similar to our own procurement. That accounts, and they are paid a service charge on per liter, so they don't control the price or anything. So that would be about 50% of our procurement, and about 30% of our procurement is through some of the agents and from some suppliers who procure the milk, charge a fixed margin and give it to us.
All right, that's very helpful, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question is from the line of Saurabh from Asian Market Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for the opportunity. So what was the FFB for this quarter?
So that is what I wanted to say, that volume wise, hold on. Yeah. So last year in H1, we did 3.21 lakh tons. This year we have done 3.06 lakh tons. Now there is a shift in the FFB procurement. So my sense is that this deficit of about 15,000 tons will be made up in November itself. So we will come back to whatever we had budgeted, and over the year there will be growth of about 8 to 10%. Easily.
Oh, and what was the oil extraction ratio?
Good question. Chalo ji. 8 minutes. OER, where is it? OER last year was 16.81% first half. Today we are at 17.75%. Last year Q2 was 17.33%, and I am very sure we'll be above 19% this year.
19% for the full year?
No, second half.
Okay.
But my sense is the way things have improving, we may get to almost close to that number on yearly basis also.
Okay. The second question is on the growth project. So we have a couple of capex coming in the animal feed and also on the aspect side. So just to want to update on the specifically on the animal feed side, the status of the project and the timeline.
So two projects were discussed last time. One was the herbicide plant, which will make sulfonyl ureas in Aztec Life Sciences. I think that has been commissioned and commercial production has started. In chemical plants, normally it takes about a quarter to hit the best efficiencies and all the expectations in terms of parameters from the plant. I think that is happening at a very fast pace. Some of the products will definitely be exported in this quarter from that plant. The second was a fish feed plant in North. I think the target date of commercial production is April 22. We maintain that. Erection of the plant has started. It is a imported plant which has already reached the site, and most probably the trial productions will start in February 22.
Okay. And so the last thing, any guidance in terms of volumes for animal feed for this year?
So my sense is that same momentum is likely to be maintained. We are in a very strong position. We have good position on raw materials also. So I think that we will repeat our performance of H1 and H2.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Next question is from the line of Abhijit Akela from IIFL Securities. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much, sir. One question on the oil palm volumes. FY21, as we know, we had a difficult year because of the whitefly attack. This year's volume recovery is a little bit, subdued in relation to that. So has there been any kind of yield loss because of, the last year's attack? And by when do we expect to sort of get back to, optimal levels of FFB shipments?
So there are two parts to your question. First and foremost, I think that all oil palm players have started implementing quality standards for fruits very strongly. Unfortunately, we never had that understanding. And now government oil mills like Telangana Oil Fed and Andhra Pradesh Oil Fed are also part of that understanding. The farmers used to harvest prematurely and we would get poor quality fruits. So my estimate is that industry is rejecting between 3-5% of the fruits. And all of us have seen major improvement in farmer behavior from the quality point of view in terms of harvesting and time of harvesting in last few months. So I can definitely tell you that about 15,000-17,000 tons of our fruit has been rejected, and we have not taken that at even lower price also just to improve the behavior of farmers. And that is one of the reasons why there is an increase in the oil extraction ratio. I must also tell you that there are innumerable research papers which say that about 30% of the oil in the fruit comes in last 20 days. So that is what is most critical, and these people, just because they want to catch good price or they have some merit, so they harvest early. And the price was being paid by the processor, because we had to accept. There was no way of punishing them because of poor OER. So I think that is one thing which is a great achievement of this industry, and we need to strengthen that. Apart from that, there is another project on with a startup where infrared technology will be used to grade the fruits, and we will trace it all the way back to the farm, because now all 35,000 hectares we have in Andhra Pradesh and Telangana has been geotagged. So that is loss one. Loss two is shifting of volumes. So that's what I said, that in spite of these rejections, we will post a 8-10% increase in volume on a year-round basis.
Okay, so got it. So next year in FY23, can we, sort of aim to get back to the pre-whitefly levels of, say, around 5.7 lakh tons of FFB arrivals?
Easily. But I must also tell you that all the tests now, while geotagging also, we did the census once again. So this problem of uprooting still continues to be rampant in this industry. So if you really ask me, now in last 5 years, we would have added about 17,000-18,000 hectares. But once we started geotagging and started counting the acreage again, so we realized that actual addition has been only 7-8,000. There has been continuous uprooting also. The second thing is, just because of technology and satellite pictures and satellite monitoring, I think the big change would be, in case we can do that, is to manage this business by trees rather than by hectare. Because once we started doing geotagging and we had to walk the plantation, we realized that plantation should have 145 trees. At least half the plantation, because of some or the other reason, has between 5 to 15 trees left. So the calculation goes haywire when you have 10% uprooting within the plantation also. So I think we have learned a lot, and I think we increasingly technology will help us monitor this business better.
Sure, sir. One last thing, the income from associate on the P&L is lower year on year. Was hoping for a breakdown between how much of that is due to ACI and how much due to any other items.
For the rest,
yeah. So Abhijit will give this.
Tell me, Abhijit.
Sorry, I couldn't catch that.
I said I will give that information offline separately, yeah?
Okay. All right, yeah. Thank you so much. All the best.
Thank you very much. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one at this time. We would like to remind our participants that you may press star and one to ask a question. Next question is from the line of Dipesh from Equirus Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Thanks for taking my question. Just one on the animal feed business. So now that the soya meal prices have dropped sharply since the end of September, I just wanted to know if you will be able to, you'll be rolling back the price hike that you've taken in the last 6 months?
Yes, we have rolled back. And almost 90% of the reduction in soya meal prices have been passed on, and not just by us, by the entire team. And we believe that it is a little bit of a hit to us also, because we had imported soya meal from Bangladesh and from Vietnam when there was shortage, and the drop in soya meal prices post 15th of October was very severe. So I think for last 2-3 weeks we are still using soya meal, which is 55,000 to 60,000 rupees a ton, whereas local soya meal in our factories is between 45,000 to 47,000 rupees a ton. But that normally happens whenever the prices fall. But my sense is that November will be better than October, and December will be much better than November. So that happens. So we are not very concerned. I said that it will be a repeat of H1 performance.
So, it was basically in the shrimp feed segment, or you're saying the entire animal feed, poultry feed also you rolled back?
Shrimp feed we have not dropped because the government had not allowed us to increase the price. But let me tell you the intervention of government in everything in Andhra Pradesh, whether it is oil palm, whether it is cattle feed, poultry feed, fish feed, shrimp feed, is progressively increasing. So, which worries the industry a little.
Right. So my question was basically that in the first half, especially in the aqua feed, the industry has seen very low margins, right, because of the soya meal prices. And now that the prices have come down and you have taken a couple of price hikes in the first half of this year, so will there be a pressure on the government to roll back the prices and give away all the benefits that you may see in the second half?
So, government may be slightly, I would say, lethargic, because this is off-season for shrimp. But my sense is that we will be able to maintain the same prices definitely till January, till the next crop season starts. And contribution per ton doubled in last 3-4 weeks.
Got it, sir. And sir, what is the outlook on the EBITDA margins for the animal feed segment as a whole? You think it will be like above 7% because of the drop in prices?
Abhijit, sir?
Abhijit, 5.7%. Segment margin.
So I'll tell you, I'm saying that just because of inflation, the top line has gone up. So in case you ask me, we normally never budget in the animal feed business EBITDA or profit as a percentage of sales. We budget in rupees per ton. So let me tell you, last year we were in H1, we were 1748 rupees per ton EBIT. So this year we are 1855 rupees per ton EBIT. And in case, my sense is that this will be definitely maintained at least.
Got it, sir. And sir, last question on the palm oil segment. I think you explained in the last question, but I just wanted to understand again that, see, in FY20 we did around 5.7 lakh tons, and at that time I think we were having 70.5 1,000 hectares under our plantation, right? So the yield was around 8%, but now the area under plantation has increased. So, what is the outlook on, sir, like FY23? Like, can we actually do more than 6 lakh tons of FFB arrivals in FY23?
So, we most likely we will be. So anything between 5.6 to 5.8 lakh tons in FY23.
Okay, so the thing that you explained about the 5 to 10% of rejection that the industries are doing, so that
now we will be ruthless, because I think the government and the farmers take us for granted. They supply a very bad product, and government is a very important player in this thing, because they control all formula. And I think it is too farmer centric. So I think that we are very sure that we are going to make sure that OER does not come down at all. So that I think then we will strengthen more and more. And another thing I just wanted to point out, that almost in Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, we have almost 30 collection centers. In FY20, all of them were manned by outside suppliers. We had outsourced that. And a collection center is a office with all facilities, internet, etc., plus a base scale, plus a big yard. And we have taken over 1/3 of collection center, put our own people there, put cameras there, etc. And we are going to take 2/3 of the collection center next year. And wherever we have taken up the collection center, OER from that fruits has improved, because we also use this center as training and development place for the farmers. So in another 2 years' time, all collection centers will be very sophisticated. They'll be having these infrared tunnels where we will pass the fruits and get an idea of oil also. So I think we have taken over, and I can give a separate presentation on that, because whatever changes needed to be made to make sure that our collection is good, the fruits come on time without losing quality, and we don't take nonsense from the farmer, has been achieved this year. And we are very happy to lose the fruit, because marginally these fruits are always bad. And I am very happy that in case these fruits go to competitor, because they get 13-14% OER out of it.
Yeah. Over time, yeah, last farmers will make sure they supply good fruit.
Right, sir, right. Yeah. And lastly, sir, on the crop protection business, I think Aztec, we already know from the last con call that was done separately. On the domestic crop protection, if you can just talk a bit, because I think earlier our target was 15% growth for the full year, but now we have actually declined in the second quarter. So what's the outlook for the full year, sir?
So not very good. So let me just tell you the 2-3 things which have happened to us. I think that dry spell has, and that has happened to everybody, that the herbicide dependent companies are in deep trouble. So that is one bad news. And in this quarter also, we will have to take returns. That is point number one. Point number two, at one time we used to make a decent margin on generic. Just because there were less number of sprays, a price war started, and we had to reduce the price. And because of that, our profitability almost vanished in generic pesticide, which is almost 1/3 of our business. We were hopeful of launching one more insecticide called Gracia, which is a product from Nissan. But unfortunately, this CIV kept on delaying meetings, etc., because of COVID, this, that, and all. A product which should have been launched in July is likely to be launched in December. So that is the third bad news. So I think that this year is not likely to be very good. And I'll be very happy if we get anything near last year's numbers. But I think the problem may be more or less with companies, but the industry is facing this problem. On the other side, Aztec Life Sciences like companies, I think we are just going to come back with a bang, because now that containers are available, that hazardous containers was a very big problem, that is available, the prices are very high. And some of the delays in exporting have also benefited us, because the raw material we had for them was at lower cost, and the price of the material which we are exporting now is higher. So I think we'll see some kind of improvement in margin per ton also. So I think it is a mixed bag. So when you see an integrated play of Aztec plus CPB we may still save our face. But if you are asking me B2C business, I think it is a very, very tough and challenging year for us.
Got it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Before we take the next question, we would like to remind participants that you may press star and one to ask a question. Next question is from the line of Sumant Kumar from Motilal Oswal. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi, sir. So can you talk about the palm oil price outlook?
Sir, would you like to enlighten them, sir?
Yeah. We expect palm oil prices to be around the same for the next 6 months. Beyond that, it is very difficult to predict, but probably the prices will fall beyond that.
Okay. And now talking about the overall palm oil plant, can you talk about the what is the utilization in H1?
So I think, how do I tell capacity? Because we have capacity of 70 plus 60 plus 50.
Yeah.
So about 180 tons of fruit per hour. But the plants are utilized fully for only 100 days, partly for about 100 days, and nothing for about 125 to 130 days, and rest is maintenance. So my sense is that giving this spread, we, and you know that we had, in FY21, we had modified one of our plants and increased capacity and sophisticated the equipment also. So we are good for 6 lakh tons of fruit in the same spread on the monthly basis. So that is the capacity according to me. Post 6 lakh tons, we will have to invest again close to about 125 crore rupees in another plant. But 6 lakh ton means that we are very good till FY23.
Okay. So what we observed in the past also, apart from the white fly impact, the competition is getting more FBB from versus ours, and we have degrown over the years. Apart from FY21, where the white fly impact, so we are getting challenges. Can you talk about that? What are the challenges we are facing in the market?
So I think let me tell you, there are three challenges. One of the challenge definitely is the white fly challenge, which we neutralized to almost 90% level this year. And we were very happy that we got that opportunity in February and March before the second wave came, that we were able to spray and other things and control. But I can definitely say that 2-3% of area is still vulnerable. And I think we will have to get back to a more aggressive control in that area. So there'll be loss of about, my sense is, 8 to 10,000 tons there. Telangana oil fed prices, which is adjacent to our mill, were slightly higher than Andhra Pradesh prices. And there was some flight of fruits to them. And in particularly in the month of July and August, not in month of September, because government of Telangana realized that the fruits which are coming to them are of very poor quality. And actually, with the kind of payment they're making to the farmers, they are not making money or losing them. So they stopped that poaching. So that is another, say, 8 to 10,000 tons. So I can definitely tell you that this 16 to 18,000 tons of fruit which belong to us and which should have come to us has gone because of white fly this year. Last year, white fly loss was close to 60, 70,000. So I think that is, these are the two challenges. Plus, there is a shifting of tonnage also. So I am quite hopeful that we will register growth over last year, come what may, and this year, without counting the two losses.
Can you talk about overall the Ravi season? The previously, the previous quarter, previous year same quarter in Q3 and Q4. Overall, we have also not done. Overall, we have done. Has shown a good numbers, but on that base and people are talking about overall Rabi season is going to be good. So what's your sense on that?
Look, I'll tell you that Rabi season is a insulated season that way. The reason is that most of the crops are very focused on areas where very good irrigation is there. For example, I would say that if you take, for example, wheat is the main rabi crop. 98% of wheat is grown in this country in irrigated areas. So that, whether you have a good monsoon or a bad monsoon, it is not affected. Plus, the very good rains in September and October beginning in certain parts of the country caused a little bit damage to the kharif crop, but definitely left a lot of moisture and water in the reservoir, as far as moisture in the soil and water in the reservoir. So irrigation for certain oil seeds like rapeseed and pulses like gram, etc., will also be pretty good. So I think the kind of risk you see in kharif, because the temperatures are very high in the country, so water is a very, very important input. You don't see that in rabi. So I feel that rabi will be improvement over last year, definitely. And you and I will shell out more and more money in subsidies and procurement, etc. So I think that story will continue. Sugarcane will be a little short, but again, the government will cover the farmers by increasing the prices. So in rural area, if you ask me, there is not much of a stress. Whatever you read is totally different now. Of course, they were hit very badly by COVID, and they are not spending, not because they don't have money, just because they know that they need money should there be a second, third wave. Because whoever had money in the first wave, in the second wave in rural areas, had better chance to survive. So entire rural India is conserving money should there be a third wave. And the government is pumping close to 20,000 crore rupees per month in rural areas. Manrega outlay is going to be about 80,000 crore for the whole year. Almost 80 crore people are being fed. More than 60% of them are in rural India. State governments are giving scheme after scheme. I think in most of the states, farmers receive between 3,000 to 5,000 rupees per month for doing nothing. So I think rural India is in pretty good shape, and that will drive growth and growth of economy in the next quarter once they are comfortable and confident that no wave 3 is there. So rural India pretty much shape. I think the bottom 20% of rural India, which is landless in water-fed areas and all, have been suffering irrespective of whatever happens. So that will continue.
So lastly, sir, can you talk about the government cut basic duty and ag?
So I'm saying government gifted more than $2.5 billion to Indonesian and Malaysian, because when they started cutting duty, the selling price of oil was 120 rupees. And every time they cut duty, it came down by 5-7 rupees and went back to 120 rupees. And that is what, because the prices were increased by Malaysian and Indonesian. So I think that is a very good gift by central government, in spite of wisdom shared by innumerable experts in this area. The Consumer Affairs Ministry prevailed and said that we need to reduce the price for consumers. I think the last duty cut definitely has had some impact, particularly soya bean oil and sun oil, etc., but not in CPO. CPO prices from 120 came down to 109, 110. So my only I would say request and expectation from the government is, when the prices start going down, they should bring back the duty with the same fervor and promptness with which they reduced it.
So the current duty is 15.25, correct?
5%.
Hello?
CPO is 5%.
Including everything, total custom duty on crude palm oil is 15.25?
Something like that. I'll just tell you, but it's a single digit, I remember. Na? So.
And there's some surcharge of that. So.
Yeah, sir. I have it, sir. I can give it now. Just a minute. So let me just read it out to you. This is on October 19th was the last one. So the crude soybean oil is 5%, soybean oil edible grade nil, crude palm oil is 7.5%, refined bleached deodorized palm oil, RBD palm oil, RBD palm stearin, and any palm oil other than crude palm oil, nil. Crude sunflower seed oil, 5%. Sunflower oil, edible grade, nil.
Then you have other surcharge also, sir. So totally 15.25, what I understood.
No. This is a...
Sir, CPO is 7.5
plus surcharge.
8.25.
10% surcharge. But I told you it is single digit, not...
Yes.
So, we'll send you the table, calculation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, that was our last question for today. I now hand the conference over to the management for closing comments. Over to you.
Thank you. I hope we have been able to answer all your questions. If you have any further questions or would like to know more about the company, we would be happy to be of assistance. Stay safe and stay healthy. Thank you once again for taking the time to join us on this call.
Thank you very much, Mr. Godrej and members of management. Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Godrej AgroVet Limited, that concludes today's conference call. Thank you all for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.